Welcome back to my YouTube channel, Professor Shourav Kaur. As I promised earlier that I will be delivering a series of lectures on the topic of repair and rehabilitation of structures. So I have brought a very interesting package of 20 plus videos on repair and rehabilitation of structures. So welcome all. Please be prepared, everyone. I will be delving and I will be discussing a lot more topics which you have not studied or which you have not detailed, analyzed this subject. The subject of repair and rehabilitation of structure has a very poignant and pivotal role to play in the civil engineering fraternity. All the new generation civil engineering students who are learning BTech undergraduate subjects, and also for the practicing engineers, they should have a knowledge and detailed analysis on the subject of repair and rehabilitation of structure. In my last video lecture, I just discussed what are the topics I will be discussing in my video lecture series. I am Professor Shourav Kaur, and I will be discussing with you the very first topic, that is deterioration and distress in structures. First of all, this is the basic topic or basic chapter which we will focus on while learning this subject. I am Professor Shourav Kaur. I am currently working as an assistant professor in the Department of Civil Engineering at Heritage Institute of Technology, Kolkata, West Bengal. If anyone, any problem, you can feel free to call me at this number, 9073-558349. And if you want to contact me through email ID, you can have my email ID, sourav.kar@heritageit.edu. So if you talk about the structures, this picture, we have seen a lot of pictures, and we have also seen the practical scenario, what happens on various types of structure surrounding us. We have seen pictures on the deck of the bridge or the underlying tension zone of bridge spans like this. Also, we have seen pictures like this whenever we have whenever we are discussing about some damage on the cement plaster, on the walls of the cement plaster. This is the left side picture, is a very nice and a very case where we see this type of failures or the peeling of the surface of cement plaster. And apart from that, if we have a very long scale or a very long-term damage, this damage which is started to act on the surface of this wall or surface of the any cement or concrete mortar paste or the hardened surface, the right side picture is a more elaborate and more detailed damage acting on the concrete structure. In the right side picture, if you see, we can see that this this area where not only spalling has taken place, I will discuss all this topic later on, but also a mass of concrete has been eaten out and the reinforcement has been exposed. It's a very pivotal and a very serious issue we should address at this stage. Because we all know that concrete structures have durability and they can stand tall till 50 to 60 years. Usually concrete structure have lifespan of 50 to 60 years, even though we claim that we design buildings for 100 years. No, for 50 to 60 years, concrete structures have the tendency and have the capability to stand tall without any damages or major damages and destruction. But beyond 50 to 60 years, whenever the concrete structure started to fail, or they started to show some signs of damages, then the subject of repair rehabilitation comes into the picture. Also, if you see, we see sometimes these reinforcement, the main bar longitudinal reinforcement is exposed, completely exposed. They have started to corrode. They have started to rust and they have started to corrode. So this is another very important issue which we normally see in normal residential buildings, in old buildings, which have not undergo proper maintenance work. Without proper maintenance, this happens. Also, sometimes we see due to proper compaction of concrete, these voids or pores are formed, which are known as honeycombing in structure. Also, we can see sometimes settling of some of the slabs, floor slabs, roof slabs, some portion of the slab, this settles down. Unequal settlement, which causes cracks. So this is another major problem. So we have a lot of problems like concrete surface eaten up. We can see the reinforcement bars exposed like earlier. We can see the voids, unwanted voids occurring in the concrete because of excessive bleeding and segregation. I hope all of you know the basics of segregation and bleeding as we have been learned in the concrete technology subject. And also unequal settlement is a very, very common problem in many residential buildings, commercial buildings and structures also. So in this subject, today I will be basically discussing first the what we will learn in this subject. We have to have a clear picture on what we will learn. Under this repair and rehabilitation of structures, the purpose of the course is to provide students with a fundamental and practical understanding. Very important, we have to know the fundamentals of this subject, as well as we need to have hands-on training on this subject. Then only these two important criteria or two important philosophies we consider, then only we can deliver or we can expect a good civil engineering student passing out from the college. So first of all, we will be discussing on concrete repair technology, the reasons for concrete damages, factors causing the concrete damage. Secondly, we will learn about the repair materials. What are the proper repair materials we can study or we can use while using this repair technology? Very important. And similarly, we also need to learn repair philosophies. Repair philosophies is nothing but the study of why we go for repair technology, why, how, and when. These three questions should come to mind for any civil engineer or civil engineer who has taken this prospect of repair and maintenance of concrete structure. Now you will wonder that why we are discussing or focusing more on concrete structures, because concrete structures, 90% of the buildings in India and also in abroad, majority of the concrete structures are concrete. They're RCC made, and RCC structures are more prone to damage and deterioration compared to steel structure. Okay, so the main important thing, the main important reason why we have selected mainly this concrete structure is that compared to steel structures, which is fabricated and which is manufactured in a very maintained environment in factories, while concrete is mainly constructed or casted in ex situ or in situ. Sometimes they may be prefabricated, but we are mainly focused on concrete which have been casted on the site, which are more vulnerable to damages. Also, large number of reinforced concrete structures are deteriorating often prematurely. That means meaning before 50 to 60 years, as I have told you, that is basically the life cycle or the lifespan of RCC structures. They are taken about 50 to 60 years. 50 to 60 years, okay? 50 to 60 years, they are taken as the basic lifespan of concrete structure. But before this 50 years, we see due to lack of maintenance or lack of proper construction, labor errors, prematurely concrete structures are getting deteriorated. So we need to have remedial measures to reinstate their safety or serviceability. As we all know that nowadays the design, the limit state design philosophy, not only focuses on the elastic design, but also it talks about safety and serviceability criteria. Also, in the subject, we will learn that the need for repair and protection has grown considerably in the recent years, because two important things are very the important functions on which we focus, that is the time and cost. The cost, it will be a very big issue for the owners as well as the constructors or the repair technicians, as well as the time required. The time and cost are the most precious material which we have to take into consideration. The cost associated with the repair of deteriorating structures can be substantial. Okay, if proper construction or proper maintenance is not there, cost will be high. Cost resulting from poorly designed or executed repairs can be even higher. So first of all, what will I think tell you that as a civil engineer, first we should focus on proper and good construction practices. If by some way or the other, if by some reasons, these proper and correct construction practices are not carried out, then we should have a proper regular maintenance of concrete structure. If proper regular maintenance means, maybe you can take quarterly in a year, or half yearly in a year, or annually, or once in 2 years or 5 years. So any structures, whether it is residential buildings, whether it is commercial buildings, whether it's public works department, all these works, whatever the construction is, we have to have proper maintenance in for proper concrete structure, whether it is bridges or buildings. The technical and economical success ranges on various factors. We have a proper condition assessment. Condition assessment means not only the maintenance, but also the report generated after the evaluation of the health of the concrete and also the proper maintenance work. Next, we have to have design and execution of remedial measures. And finally, design and implementation of maintenance strategy. So three things important: proper condition assessment, design and execution of remedial measures, design and execution of maintenance strategies. Now, the first scope or the first topic in this subject is the basic introduction about damage, deterioration, all this dilapidation, what is the meaning of damage, distress, and also what are the main pivotal causes? What are the causes and what can be the preventive measure? Preventive measures we can learn on a later section in the lecture. But mainly, our focus will be on this introduction. What is the main definition or the main introduction? What do you mean by deterioration? Because in this subject, in the world of repair and rehabilitation, we have six different R's. We have six different R's, where they are very much near to each other, but also they have a fine line of difference. R stands for repair, R stands for rehabilitation, R stands for retrofitting, R stands for all this remuneration and all these rehabilitation systems. So deterioration, distress, and cost. So all these things we will learn, and mainly we will be focusing on the causes. First, the damage and distress. Damage, what we can say, damage can occur due to the overloading beyond capacity which the structure can take. That means if we are overloading the structure, it can be dead load, it can be live load, it can be wind load, it can be earthquake loads. Whenever the design permissible limits or the loading which is coming on the structure is beyond the design loads, then we will term it as an overloading beyond capacity. Next, damage or distress can occur due to deterioration due to degradation of material leading to serviceability limit failure. That means not only the overloading is one of the criteria, but also we can have a lot of reasons like degradation of materials. The materials we have used for construction, they have degraded. Their quality have decreased or decremented year by year. The type of concrete, the proper M30 concrete which you have constructed or which you have used for construction, for example, you have used M30 concrete with some super plasticizers and you have used Fe500 steel of some important or very good company, over the years, the quality will deteriorate. Now, if initially at the time of construction, if you use a very poor quality of material, then from the beginning only, your problem, your headache will start. And lastly, most often, litter may not lead to collapse, although overloading may lead to collapse. That means that it may happen, the structure is not fully undergoing failure. The structure might happen, the structure will not collapse or fail, but it will give you warnings. There will be stages before collapse, before failure. And as inhabitants or as the living inmates of the building, you will be really worried that when will the day will come when the construct the structure, it may be beams, it may be affected beams, slabs, columns will fail. So you will wait for that day. So instead of waiting for that day, you have to pick up your phone, you have to call your engineer and tell him to go for site supervision and also the checkup, health checkup of the concrete structure. Also, we can see life, very important thing, the life of the concrete structure. Life is intended, design life, physical, economical, functional, service life, residual life depends upon the context. So only the life of concrete structure, we not only explain or we not only understand that only it is design life, but also it can be physical, economic, functional, service life, residual life depends upon the context. So these are the very important factors which has brought the much importance of this subject. The life of concrete structure is at stake. We have a common notion, a renowned engineer, Broglie, have mentioned few decades back that if you take care of concrete, concrete will take care of you. So if this notion, if any engineer takes it seriously, he or she will surely deliver a good maintained and good repaired concrete structure without any hassle and without much cost. Cost effectiveness is a very important issue. Now we will just talk about chemical energy balance. While producing clinker, that is the cement production, we use this clinker and the spherical globules in the manufacturing plants. So if you talk about regarding the heat losses, it is about 0.2%. If you talk about the total complete energy of 100%, if you distribute the energy required, the energy emitted due to production of cement, which is inadvertently produced from cement clinker. 0.2% heat losses. Then we have 13% expulsion or removal of hot air. We have 16.5% exhaust gases from the combustion of pet coke, 1.8% sensible heat of clinker, and the last 68.5% is useful energy. So among this complete 100% energy distribution related with the cement production and clinker, 68.5% energy is used. That means 68.5% energy is utilized for production of cement. But as we know, cement production leads to a huge amount of environmental pollution. Environmental hazards are a big problem here. We all know that 1 kg of cement production leads to release a production of 990 grams of carbon dioxide. So to reduce this environmental hazard or to reduce the pressure on environmental impact, we use various supplementary cementitious material, which can be used as an alternative to cement. We use fly ash of usually about 30 to 40%. Sometimes we use fly ash as a high volume fly ash content of 70 to 80%, obviously as a replacement of cement. We use GGBFS, blast furnace slag. We use nano silica, silica fume. We have alkafine, very fine slag. So there are various supplementary cementitious material which are available in the market, which reduces the pressure or which reduces the carbon footprint. Sorry, let me bring back to the slides first. Yes. After that, yes, I was talking about cementitious supplementitious material, or supplementary cementitious material is called SCM. The short form, it is known as SCM. We have, let me write in the screen. We have SCM, sorry. Yeah. We have supplementary cementitious material SCM. Also nowadays we have coming a new type of cementitious materials known as ACSSCM, alternative supplementary cementitious material. Also we are using like synthetic aggregates, we are using recycled concrete aggregates, all these are the types. Pozzolana, yeah, supplementitious cementitious material. When we talk about pozzolana, a pozzolanic feature is very important. Now, pozzolana, what it does, it reacts with lime to produce a carbon calcium CSH gel, calcium sulfide hydride, calcium silicate hydride gel. Fly ash, we all know, I talked about fly ash, an important pozzolanic material and one of its primitive types. Product from thermal power plant collected as ESP. ESP, we all know, electrostatic precipitator. Fly ash, basically the ashes which are not settled down, but they are the flue. They are the very lightweight ashes, a lightweight, very powdery form, which are basically floating in the electrostatic precipitator. They are collected from flue gases. Yes, if you talk about production energy, how much energy is produced? I told you that cement requires about 3.72 million joule per kg. 3.72, no, it's not million, it's mega, okay, 10 to the power 3. So cement is 3.72 mega joule per kg, which requires a temperature of 1400 degrees Celsius. If you come from cement production, if you drop down to cement production to lime, then hydrated lime, burn clay pozzolana, rice husk ash, turkey, fly ash, silica, and silica fume, you can see the energy required is less. The energy required for production coming drop is dropping down from 3.72 to 1.73. And if you talk about fly ash, it is very, very, very less amount of energy is required. Okay. So our main concept or our main aim of making a very eco-friendly and a very cost-effective production or produced cost-effective produced material, that the total energy required for production will be less. As I told you, cement, if you talk about OPC, ordinary Portland cement, it is highest, 3.72 mega joule per kg. So energy remains locked up in cementitious material. You see, energy remains locked up in cementitious material. One research shows that 3.23 megajoule per kg enthalpy and nearly similar energy for cement. So this 3.23 megajoule per kg, they are also again distributed among the various Bokes compound, which takes place as a product of hydration product. So when the water reacts with cement, we have C3S, tricalcium silicate. We have dicalcium silicate, C2S, tetracalcium aluminate, and tetracalcium aluminoferrite. C3S, tricalcium silicate, C2S, dicalcium silicate, C3A, tricalcium aluminate, and C4AF, tetracalcium aluminoferrite. So these four are the popular Bokes compound we all have learned in concrete technology subject. And the joules per gram, how much energy they produce, they have been given. Now, coming from the energy potential towards the sustainability of concrete. Now, two important aspects which come in the concrete structure. First is durability, and second is sustainability. These two words are the keywords of this decade. Considerable chemical potential even after hydration is a very important aspect. What happens, why we are talking about this issue of with this chemical energy is that why and how the cement or concrete structures are more prone to vulnerability and more prone to damage. What happens, the cement or concrete structure, they're eventually exposed to air. They're exposed to air, moisture, which will be converted to this calcium carbonate and silica. So all these ingredients, these Bokes compound available inside the cement, which has formed after the hydration process, they remains exposed to air, moisture, and all these Bokes compound, they're converted to calcium carbonate or calcium salts and silica. Also, steel and alloys from extracted metals, even at a very higher chemical potential, hence readily oxidizes in the atmosphere. So that means we also have the ill effect of the reinforcement material. Like we have, sometimes we use steel wire mesh, we use reinforcement bars as the longitudinal bar. Okay, so steel and alloys, they are also very much vulnerable to exposure and also for corrosion. Aggregates, as it has been chemically proven or as it has been scientifically proven, that aggregates are largely inert, but not all aggregates. All aggregates are not actually inert. They are taken to be inert, but we have the phenomena of ASR, we all know, alkali silicate reaction, ASR. We also have AAR, alkali aggregate reaction, AAR. We have a number of problems regarding with aggregates also. We have alkali silicate reaction, which is another very popular factor for the scaling or spalling of concrete structures. We have AAR, alkali aggregate reaction. So due to all these reasons, we have concrete or reinforced or pre-stressed concrete can change chemically with time and have tendency to change its chemical properties. And once this concrete or reinforced concrete or pre-stressed concrete, they start to chemically change, their behavior chemically changes, then the problem of damage comes. Life of the structure, as I told you earlier, is basically the intended life, design life. We have the physical life, how much it will be physically sustainable. That means how for how many years or for how many days will the concrete structure will be standing tall. Economic life means how much economy we have to invest. And functional life, that's the lifespan, the design lifespan, or how much the span it will sustain. Also, we have the surface life period concept, which comes in a different aspect. We have the remaining residual life, and from current condition, RL can also be estimated. The residual life can also be estimated from structural audit. Structural audit is a very important issue which we undergo to check the health and conditional assessment of the concrete structure. Structural audit, only if we do structural audit, then only this remaining or residual life. Residual life means what is the remaining life period or for how many years remaining for this concrete structure so that it will be absolutely fine and standing tall. Residual life meanings, it has, for example, it has given a service period for about 40 to 50 years. And after some damages, we will undergo structural auditing. We will check what are the problems involved there, what are the damages occurring in the structure. And then after that, we can decide or we can come to a conclusion, what is the remaining lifespan for the structure. The structure can be bridges, the structure can be flyovers, the structure can be residential buildings. This is an important graph which talks about the degradation and life service. Very important. Life service and degradation are more, they are like brothers, they are more interlinked to each other. Concrete is not maintenance free, I told you. Concrete requires maintenance, it requires care. It is produced at the expense of energy. That means a good, sustainable concrete or durable concrete, they can only be available to us only if we spend money on those. Concrete degrades with time, we all know. And if we check this graph, if we have this degradation versus the time graph, and if we see during the service life, as the service life proceeds, for example, from if you have done a construction in the year 2000, over 2000 to 2005, 2010, 2020, with the development or the progress of service life or the progress of years, the degradation slightly increases. See, the graph is not linear. Very interestingly, the graph is not linear. It is parabolic. That means with gradual increase in time, the degradation will be gradually increased. And we as structural engineers, or we as a designer, or we as a researchers, we have to find out this equation for this graph. For various structures, what will be the equation for this parabolic graph? Okay, and based on this R factor, if you plot this graph, we can have an R factor. And based on this R factor, we can find out that how much lifespan is there for the concrete structure. So at this stage, at one point of time, we will reach the serviceable limit. Even the serviceable limit increases or exceeds, we have to go for maintenance. So for this portion where the graph between degradation and service life has exceeded the serviceability limit, there we have to go for maintenance. Okay, at this juncture, if you check here, at this juncture we have to go for maintenance. Okay, M stands for maintenance. So the graph is not linear, the graph is parabolic. See here, if we can extend that graph, if we extend the graph, the previous graph is this the graph which I'm showing about. It's a very short lived. For example, you have done a construction at the end on the or in the year of 2000, and you have plotted a graph of degradation and time variance for 2000 to 2005. So this is a short lived graph. And if we extend the graph, it will look like this. If you see the degradation, normally accepted performance, this line, dotted line is given here. This is the serviceability or the permissible limits. And it will gradually, it will take a parabolic shape. And if there is no proper maintenance, it will be tend to decrease. If there is no maintenance, it will start to decrease. So this is the time. So this is a basically a time-related study where this is a completely a different scenario or different scope of study. So where basically the structural auditors, they study the structure and they plot this graph with your lifespan versus the degradation. So we have normally accepted performance level, this red one, and also we have this serviceability limit. The serviceability limit is the higher, the what you can say, the upper bound scale. This is the upper bound scale and this is the lower bound scale. Okay. Intended life, it is given by T suffix IDL. Okay. So T0 is the initial time. T0 is the initial time of construction when the concrete has just, or the structure has just undergone construction. Now these are the life cycle span, the life cycle study regarding this concrete, how much the concrete structure will sustain. And the durability aspect, there are a lot of studies involved there. But we as a civil engineers, we are not so much interested to study the life cycle and the maintenance period, but we are mainly focused on the practical aspect, like what is the causes of damage, what is the repair technique, or what is the retrofitting technique, so that I can increase the strength carrying capacity of the structure. So see here, the very important pivotal factors which is coming to play: degradation and chemical attack. Okay, degradation and chemical attack is one of, there are a lot of factors. I will show you on a different lecture class that we have about 20 to 30 main factors acting behind this deterioration and damage of concrete structure. But among them, this chemical attack or these chemical causes is the most hazardous and dangerous for concrete structure. So that is why I have put up this issue of chemical attack in the starting of this point. Degradation process, we have sulfate attack. Sulfates, we have wherever we have any concrete structures which is located in the side of the river, in the side of the sewer canals, the concrete structure which is existing in the marine offshore area, or the shores of sea and oceans, all those chemical, all these concrete structures, they are always subjected to marine water and salty water. They're always exposed to that salty water. So that exposure of salty water to the concrete structure has a very hazardous effect. The most important effect is this sulfate attack. Sulfate attack, if you see seawater attacks, acid attack, we can have some dissolved acids, like we have dissolved hydrochloride, nitric acid, and sulfuric acid, they dissolved in the water. All they react in water, they are in solution phase. So these acids, when they are in a water, they are in a diluted state, and they in the diluted state or dissolved state, they react with the concrete surface, and the concrete surface corrodes. We always talk about the corrosion of concrete surface subjected to marine water. Another important chemical aspect of the chemical damage, or chemical cause, is carbonation and chloride ingress leading to rebar corrosion. That means whenever carbonation involved, it is a phenomena I will discuss in my later lectures. Carbonation is basically the entry of carbonates. Whenever the calcium carbonate present in the concrete, present within the microstructure of concrete, they react with water, and this carbonation is basically what happens. Some of the concrete portion, some of the concrete mass, they are subjected to carbonation, calcium carbonate, or any form of carbonate salts are formed. Chloride ingress, chloride salts comes like sodium chloride, potassium chloride, or all sorts of salts, and they have a very bad effect on the corrosion of reinforcing bars. Rebar corrosion is a very problematic. Another chemical factor is the alkali aggregate reaction. I told you, alkali silica gel. We have frost action. Whenever we in cold areas, primarily in cold areas, frost action, that is subsequent frosting and defrosting. In the wind, in the night time, we have this quick frosting. The temperature is coming down from 5 degree to minus 10 degree Celsius. That is the quick frosting. And the defrosting stage, the defrosting occurs during the daytime, where the temperature is more, and when it is called thawing also. Defrosting is also known as thawing. Okay. Lastly, the corrosion of embedded metals. Corrosion is of embedded metals is the most common deterioration leading to early repair. So, with respect to all the other factors like sulfate attack, acid attack, chloride attack, carbonation, alkali aggregate reaction, frost action, corrosion of the main bars, I'm talking about the longitudinal bars, stirrups, any sort of steel bar present inside the concrete. If they get an entry to the exposed air, then it will hardly take few years to completely damage the interior phase of the concrete structure, if I'm talking about RCC. Sulfate attacks, if you talk about in detail, sulfates reacts with calcium hydroxide and C3A, calcium tetracalcium aluminate, and forms ettringite gel and gypsum. So it's obviously these are the complex microscopic structure. They are microstructural compounds formed and which inadvertently causes the interior damage of concrete. Okay. Very interestingly, please listen, this causes the interior damage of concrete. Okay, so here we can see the reaction between calcium hydroxide and sodium sulfate, where the production of calcium sulfate along with sodium bicarbonate or sodium hydroxide is formed. So sulfate, it is basically completely the chemical reactions are involved here. Also, this calcium sulfate, the magnesium sulfate reacts with calcium hydroxide, forming calcium sulfate and magnesium hydroxide, a basic double displacement reaction which we have learned in our chemistry days, in the class, in the school elementary days. The calcium sulfate leads to formation of ettringite. Ettringite is basically a complex gel. If we take SEM or TEM images, that is a scanning electron image, SEM and TEM images, then we will be able to find the study of ettringite. CSH gel, calcium silicate hydrate gel, is unstable in magnesium hydroxide environment. CHS decomposes and magnesium silicate hydrate formed, which has no binding property. So very interestingly, if you come back to the previous slide, the first thing is that the sulfates which are available in the marine environment, the sulfates in water, they react with calcium hydroxide and calcium silicate, calcium tricalcium aluminate present in the cement concrete to form calcium sulfate. Okay. This calcium sulfate is first product which is formed. This calcium sulfate again reacts with your magnesium salt to form magnesium hydroxide. And very interestingly, magnesium hydroxide is very unstable. And this calcium sulfate forms ettringite. CSH is very unstable, as you know, from basics of concrete technology. This magnesium hydroxide, which is formed, they reacts with calcium silicate hydrate gel, which has no binding property. That means the binding strength, the compressive strength, the interior compressive strength of the cement concrete mass, which you have created or constructed during the construction time. For example, if you have used M30 grade concrete at the time of construction, after 10 years or 20 years, that M30 will not be absolutely the M30 grade. It might The strength or quality of concrete might decrease very slightly. And at this stage, here comes the various concept of NDTs, like non-destructive tests, like we have rebound hammer test, we have UPB test, which checks the quality, the uniformity, and the standard of the existing concrete structure. Again, after this magnesium hydrate, magnesium silicate hydrate gel, white crystals of gypsum and cracking spalling results. So have you understood? I hope you have understood how sulfur attacks causes cracking and spalling in concrete structures. So see, these are the very, very hazardous cases. This is the picture. This is the real-time picture of a building which has undergone sulfate attack. Uncontrolled sulfate attack. This building was actually near a coastal area in Puri. This problem is basically observed in the coastal area, in the areas which are near the marine or sea and oceans, like we have Goa, we have Puri. So all those areas, the sulfate attack has occurred in the ceiling, in the slab. Next is acid attack. Acid attack is another, I told you, one of the important factors of chemical problems. Portland cement environment is alkaline. We all know, very interestingly, I don't know how much of you, how much people you know, but Portland cement environment always alkaline. The alkaline means the basic pH level is kept between 6.5 to 9.5. Okay. So this alkaline environment, they're attacked by acids. So from the basics of our elementary days, from the elementary school days, from the knowledge of chemistry, we know that whenever an acid comes in contact with alkaline environment, salts and waters are formed. Similarly, sulfur dioxide, carbon dioxide and other fumes in presence of moisture attack concrete in industrial situation. Okay, so basically these acid attack mainly we can observe in marine environment or also in factories which are producing hazardous chemicals, or the factories or the power plants which are producing some toxic chemicals. In those areas, the oxides of sulfur, primarily sulfur dioxide, carbon dioxide and other fumes present in the smoke, they attack the concrete. That means the complete, only the smokes which if they are, if the concrete is exposed to the smokes, then only automatically acid attack will take place. Because we all know this sulfur dioxide, carbon dioxide, they are acidic oxides. They react with the moisture in, they react with the moisture present in the atmosphere. They form H2SO3, that is, we may have sulfuric acid formation. We may have sulfuric acid formation we have. We have carbonic acid, H2CO3. And these acids, in the vapor form, they attack the concrete surface. I told you, due to this acid attack, the pH level decreases. The pH level comes below 6.5. pH level 6.5, less than 6.5, attack initiates, and it is severe if the pH is less than 4.5. So very interestingly, as I told you, for alkaline nature or alkaline environment, our pH should be between 6.5 to 8.5, but due to acid attack, the pH comes down to less than 6.5, and if it is less than 4.5, it is severe. The attack by dissolving and removal of parts of cement, hydrates normally leaves weak masses, okay? Reduction of calcium hydroxide, by treatment of sodium silicate helps in formation of calcium silicate and reduction of calcium hydroxide. So these are the things I told you, that the acids, when they react with the alkalis, calcium hydroxide is a very well-known alkalis. All of you, I know that in cement, what are the chemical ingredients? We all know. We have silica, SiO2, Al2O3, Na2O, K2O, CaO. These are the primary chemical ingredients present in cement apart from Bux compound. So these alkali, these are the oxides. These are the basic oxides. These basic oxides, when they are converted to alkalis like calcium hydroxide, potassium hydroxide or sodium hydroxide, these hydroxides, these alkalis, they get reacted with the acids and salts are formed. See, the formation of calcium silicate and formation of and reduction of calcium hydroxide. So, by and by, from the chemical equilibrium concept, the chapter which we have learned while studying the chemical reactions in class 11 standard of, or in all the schools in Indian version, the chemical equilibrium talks about that whenever there is a reaction between reactants, the quantity of products goes on increasing and the quantity of reactants goes on decreasing. So here the quantity of reactant calcium hydroxide is reducing and the formation, the product of calcium silicate is increasing. Surface treatment and coating reduces the risk of such attack. So many times I will show you by talking about the repair techniques. We have some surface coating. We have base coating which we directly apply on the concrete surface. We have some coatings also. We have surface binders. So by applying all these various types of chemicals, the chemicals can be inorganic and organic polymers also. Okay. So see here, such a very, very hazardous effect. This is the case what happens in acid attack on an embankment, or if you talk about a shear wall, or if you talk about the embankment wall of bridges or any canals. See what is the fate of the normal concrete structure due to acid attack. due to acid attack, not only the cement mortar has eaten up, but also the aggregate, they are completely getting exposed. All the small size aggregate, the large size aggregate, all they are coming exposed. That means the basic layer of cement concrete mortar is removed. Coming to alkali aggregate reaction, AAR, or alkali synthetic reaction, which everyone have studied in their concrete technology days. Alkali aggregate, and sometimes we have alkali silica reaction. Okay. So alkali aggregate reaction, AAR, it is in the short form, it is known as AAR. And if silica comes, it is called ASR. If silica comes into the picture, it is known as ASR, alkali silicate, alkali silica reaction. So what happens? Active silica, that is SiO2, they constitute in the aggregate. When present, can react with the alkali present the cement, resulting in alkali silica reaction. So alkali silica, all the silicates SiO2, which are present in the aggregates, mind it, they present in the aggregates, they react with the alkali present the cement. Then all the silica, that is silica SiO2, they react with the all these alkalis like Na2O or K2O, or alkalis like calcium hydroxide. The reactive forms of silica are, see, they have opal, chalcedony, and tridymite, and may occur in several rocks also. One of the active silica, if you know, is available from volcanic, that is the cold product of magma, which is the cold product of lava which we get after volcanic eruption. We get alkali silica also from those areas. Sodium oxide, Na2O and K2O, potassium oxide in cement, form the hydroxides, react with siliceous minerals forming alkali silicate gel. Okay, so alkali silicate gel, they are formed. So this is the product of alkali aggregate reaction. And see how this case of how this alkali silicate reaction, how we can identify. We can see there are some patches are formed on the surface of concrete. Patches are formed on the surface of concrete. With this, by visualizing this crack formation or these patches on the surface of concrete, we can predict that yes, this might be the reason for alkali silicate reaction. One thing is very important, my dear student, that in this subject, there is nothing called absolute. We cannot come to any statement that, yes, this is the main reason. We can just predict, we can justify, or we can list down a lot of probable reasons coming, which is acting due to the damage in concrete. That is the main thing in the subject. We cannot directly come to a conclusion with a perfect singular answer. We can come to a prediction, we can come to a statement where a lot of factors, a lot of reasons will be listed down. Alkali, another form of alkali aggregate reaction, if you see on the surface of the concrete structures exposed to the marine environment, very whitish form of patches are formed. Action of frost. I told you action of frost mostly observed in cold areas. What happens? The gel water, that is the CSH gel, that is the CSH calcium silicate hydrate gel, CSH gel, which is also known as tobermorite, and intrinsic gel, they move to capillary pores once ice formation and are taken place there and freezes increasingly hydraulic pressure. So if, for example, let me take you, if there is, for example, there is a slight formation of cracks. If there is slight formation of cracks in concrete, let me show you. And for example, I have this concrete mass. For example, I have this formation of this concrete mass and this water. This water, what happens? The gel, I'm talking about in a larger scale. This water, what happens during the winter time or during the night time, whenever the temperatures come below the 0 degree Celsius, this water turns into ice, and this ice, they exert pressure on the concrete surface. You see, this water, which is during the daytime, is in liquid form. During the nighttime, it has converted to frost. And see, they are exerting pressure on the concrete. And this pressure they are exerting on the concrete surface. So this can happen on a macroscopic scale. This can happen on microscopic scale also. Here in this slide, the gel water which is talking about, that is, they're talking about the microscopic scale. Okay. Action of frog, the extent of damage can be surface scaling. Surface scaling is basically the removal, just like we have the onion, the peeling of the or the scaling of onion, the layers of onion. Similarly, surface scaling is basically the peeling of the surface layer. Just like snakes, they scale off their dead cells or dead skin. Similarly, concrete also, the scaling takes place. The scaling to complete disintegration as layers of ice are formed, initiating from the surface. It can start from the surface and also it can progress through the depth. I showed you, it will start from the surface and it will propagate to a large, a long depth also. Frost action, see here, I have showed you a picture where we can see on the surface of the concrete structure, we can have internal leaching, scalings on the surface of concrete, we can have scalings, the large scaling, we have pop-outs means small dots. Okay, so scaling and spalling, these are the major surface phenomena. We have decracking, all these things I will discuss in details. The long, the singular longitudinal cracks, they are known as mapping, maps or crazing or decracking. Sometimes we can have internal damage and scaling also, internal phenomena. Decracks, scaling, pop-outs, they are all surface phenomena. They basically, the main occurrence or the main factor occurs within the surface of concrete, but their outlook or their visualization is on the surface. Just like we human beings, whatever our character is, we properly maintain our attitude, we maintain our behavior, we maintain our body language, we properly dress ourselves and come to public. Similarly, all these problems of scaling, honeycombing, leaching, pop-outs, they basically are the internal phenomena, but they come to visualization on the surface of concrete. Corrosion, one of the most important factors coming into play of damage. Corrosion is basically, corrosion is not erosion. Corrosion is basically the eating up or the removal of concrete mass and the exposure of reinforcement bar to the air. What happens? Very common type, reaction of iron with its environmental causes. Loss of material from structural form where iron is, okay? So the bar which is present, the bar, for example, I have this, for example, if I have this marker and if I have this pen, for example, this is a bar and I have a diameter of 18 mm diameter I have used. Due to corrosion, it can happen that this 18 mm bar have got reduced, the amount of iron has reduced, and now it is come to a diameter of 16 or 15 mm. So this is the loss, that is the loss of corrosion. Loss of metal deterioration leading to impediment to functional performance is corrosion in engineering sense. Just a minute, let me bring back to the screen. We are talking about the corrosion. Another, when functional performance remains unaffected by reaction, it may not be corrosion in engineering sense. When functional performance remains unaffected, meaning the strength carrying capacity, functional performance, if I highlight this area, functional performance means when we're talking about the amount of reinforcement or the strength carrying capacity As we know, steel bars, they have a high tensile strength. They have a high tension carrying capacity. So this decrease in the amount of reinforcement or decrease in the amount of steel results in decrease in the tension carrying capacity. Classification can be low temperature, corrosion if we talk about, it can be of low temperature or high temperature, direct or electrochemical corrosion or wet corrosion or dry corrosion. So we can have low temperature corrosion, high temperature corrosion, direct or electrochemical corrosion or wet or dry corrosion. Wet corrosion occurs in presence of liquids, water in aqueous solution or electrolytes. Rebar corrosion is basically the wet corrosion. See, rebar corrosion is basically wet corrosion in presence of water. I told you corrosion is basically the envelope or the envelope topic. Corrosion can occur on any steel wire mesh. Corrosion can occur on rebars, reinforcement bars. And we know whenever this iron, it reacts with water, Fe plus H2O, it forms Fe2O3 and Fe3O4. The various iron oxides of valency 2 and 3, these iron oxides, they are the main reason behind rusting. So we have the galvanic cell. If you talk about this electrochemical corrosion, they are the corrosion. We have talked about electrolytic corrosion is basically the corrosion which we study in the laboratory cases. Corrosion process, presence of both oxygen and moisture is necessary for corrosion reaction to progress. Okay, very important. Oxygen and moisture both are important. If you see, this is the picture I'm showing about, that if this is the reinforcement bar, this is the reinforcement bar which is embedded inside the concrete, and a lot of your products, we have Fe2O3 plus H2O is the rust, 2Fe2O3 plus H2O is the rust. Okay, and so due to this corrosion, what happens? That anodes and cathodes are formed. Which is the anode, which is the cathode? Here we can see this steel bar remains at the cathode, concrete remains the anode. Okay, so there is an exchange of ions also. Okay, not only so, the reaction is 4FeOH whole thrice plus O2 plus 2H3, 2FeOH whole thrice, which again converts to 2Fe2O3 plus H2. So this formation of rust is basically the reason for corrosion. Active and passive corrosion. Passive corrosion refers to inert condition when corrosion reaction is slow or negligent. At pH, obviously another cause, that is what is the content of pH, condition of pH. At high pH, oxides form black rust, tend to form a passive layer and protect the rebar. And some of these are the pictures where we have gone for some practical structural auditing on a dam surface wall. This is the dam of a very small dam which is present in Karnataka. And went there, and there's a team of a lot of civil engineers and professors who went there and went for some structural auditing. And we have studied all these embankment. I told you, this is basically the embankment of the dam, and we have studied what are the various damages visualized on the surface, and we have tried to find out that internal, the external feasibility and all these things. Thank you everyone for this. All this I have to talk in this lecture class. In the upcoming lecture series, in the upcoming lecture videos, I will be talking about the visual assessment, condition assessment and all the other important factors. But today I have basically focused on the chemical factors, how the concrete gets corroded and what is the reason behind that and what are the chemical reactions involved. Okay, so that is all from here. Stay safe and thank you very much. In my next lecture classes, I will be coming with the further topics.